Symptoms of gonorrhea can be significant. As a result, gonorrhea is something you definitely don't want to get, but if you do, you want to be able to recognize the symptoms, how it's diagnosed, and also how it's treated. Because if left untreated, this could cause severe complications and permanent damage in some people. Well, today's your lucky day, because we're going to talk about what gonorrhea is, the signs and symptoms, which is probably what you're here for, the complications, how it's diagnosed, and also how it's treated. And you definitely want to pay attention to that because it changed recently. With that being said, it's going to be a quick video, so pay close attention. Let's dive in. Welcome back to my YouTube channel, where I break down complex medical conditions and make them a little bit easier to absorb, because we all know about some of those educational videos that can be pretty boring. Again, we're going to talk about chlamydia's partner in crime, gonorrhea. Real quick, if you enjoy this video or if you just want to support my channel, please punch that like button and subscribe below. First, we're going to start off with some fun facts, and yes, they're going to be fun, I promise. Fun fact number one, gonorrhea is the second most common bacterial sexually transmitted disease in around 1 million Americans, and tens of millions of people worldwide get infected with gonorrhea annually. Fun fact two, in the 1500s, mercury, which is bad, was injected inside somebody's urethra. Remember, the urethra is that tube that takes urine from the bladder to the outside of the body. They injected mercury inside the urethra as a form of treatment for gonorrhea. Crazy. Fun fact three, Neisseria gonorrhea is becoming more and more resistant to antibiotics. So what does that mean? That means that the antibiotics that we used 30 years ago or 20 years ago or even 10 years ago just doesn't cut it anymore. So we either have to increase the dose or change the antibiotics in general. This is why practicing safe sex practices to reduce the spread of gonorrhea is critical. That wraps up today's facts. Stay to the very end because we're going to talk about some pretty interesting myths. Hint, how you catch gonorrhea. Also, please comment below if you have any crazy myths that you want me to answer, or if you just got any questions. When we say gonorrhea, we're talking about the bacteria Neisseria gonorrhea, which causes the STD gonorrhea. But Neisseria gonorrhea can cause infections throughout the body. So why should you be concerned about gonorrhea? Well, gonorrhea can cause several different issues for both men and for women. In women, gonorrhea can cause a myriad of issues. One of the issues is urethritis, which is inflammation and infection of the urethra. We talked about it a little bit earlier. The urethra is that tube that takes urine from the bladder to the outside of the body. Gonorrhea can also cause cervicitis in women, which is inflammation and infection of the cervix. The cervix is that donut-shaped structure in the vaginal canal. That's actually the area in which we swab for pap smears. And the cervix is the most common location of gonorrhea infection in women. Unfortunately, women can also develop pelvic inflammatory disease from gonorrhea. That's when the infection goes up into the uterus and into the fallopian tubes, potentially leading to infertility in some people. I created an in-depth video on pelvic inflammatory disease if you're curious for a little bit more information. Another catastrophic concern is gonorrhea complications during pregnancy. Gonorrhea can infect the membranes that surround the fetus and also the amniotic fluid. This could lead to sepsis and potential death. Not only can that occur, but some women can have preterm delivery, spontaneous abortion, and other severe complications. Men can sometimes have far less complications. I'm sorry, ladies. But they could still develop urethritis, but they could also develop epididymitis. Epididymitis is inflammation and infection of the epididymis. The epididymis is that structure behind each testicle that can get inflamed and cause severe pain in some patients. Now moving on to the part you're probably here for, and that's the gonorrhea STD signs and symptoms in both men and women. Some women can develop pain with urination, increased vaginal discharge, pelvic or abdominal pain, bleeding between menses, which is the period, and also some women can develop bleeding after intercourse, but most commonly, women are asymptomatic. Men can have similar symptoms. They could have pain with urination, They could have thick pus-type discharge coming from the penis. It could be white, it could be yellow, it could be green. They could also have testicular pain. This is more rare, but most commonly they're asymptomatic. Also remember, gonorrhea could end up in the eyes, the rectum, the throat, along with other places. So stay tuned, I'm gonna make a video on that in the future. The next question is, how do we diagnose the STD gonorrhea? The gold standard method to diagnose gonorrhea is through a NAAT panel, that's N-A-A-T. That stands for a nucleic acid amplification testing. I know it's a long, complicated word that you don't necessarily need to know. For men, they get a NAAT first catch urine, meaning they pee in a little cup that gets sent for diagnostic evaluation to confirm gonorrhea. So the question is, who needs to do that? If you've been positively exposed to a gonorrhea positive person, or if somebody's having symptoms, you should get tested along with a full STD panel. Now there's another option out there, guys, and some old school providers still do it, and that's swabbing the pee hole, the urethra, to get a sample and send for confirmation. Now, there's no need to do that these days as you can urinate in a cup. So if a provider asks to do that on you, maybe choose to do the urine instead. Women are a little bit different when it comes to testing. The recommendation is still a NAAT, but a swab should be performed inside the vaginal canal by either the patient or the provider, because a urine specimen is just less reliable for women than in men. The treatment of uncomplicated gonorrhea is simply an injection of ceftriaxone, also called Rocephin, in the United States. That's barring any allergy to this medication. It used to be that gonorrhea was treated with a dual therapy of ceftriaxone and azithromycin, but over the last year, this has changed. Many times, providers decide to treat empirically. And what does empirically mean? It means that a provider will decide to treat with antibiotics before the results come back, based on the patient's symptoms or if they are positively exposed to gonorrhea. You may be thinking to yourself, why would a provider start an antibiotic regimen before the results come back? Well, these tests can take several days to over a week to get back. And we talked about all those complications like pelvic inflammatory disease that could occur due to gonorrhea. As a result, we don't want to delay treatment and want to start treatment as soon as possible. If a provider decides to treat empirically, they have to cover for chlamydia and gonorrhea because the symptoms are very similar. In this case, patients are usually started on ceftriaxone and doxycycline, or they can be started on ceftriaxone and azithromycin, but it all depends on the particular patient. Remember, anybody who's treated for gonorrhea should wait 7 days after their last dose of antibiotics to resume intercourse. Always consult with your primary care provider because these antibiotic regimens frequently change. And you also want to discuss the risks, the benefits, and the alternatives. So we covered how gonorrhea is treated, but how do we prevent gonorrhea from happening in the first place? Wearing a condom is incredibly important. Although it's not 100%, it still significantly reduces your chances of getting gonorrhea. Another option is abstinence. I know that's not the most popular one, but if you're abstinent, you can't get gonorrhea. If you're in a long-term relationship and you plan on being monogamous, it's always safe for you and your partner to get an STD panel prior to starting any intercourse. On to the myths y'all all been waiting for. Myth number one. If your partner tests negative for gonorrhea, you are safe to have unprotected intercourse. This is false. Both partners should always get checked for sexually transmitted diseases because although you may have been in a monogamous relationship before, you don't know if your partner was scandalous in the past. Also, people can be asymptomatic, so both partners should always get checked. Myth number two, you can get gonorrhea through toilet seats. We heard this one a lot, but it is false. Gonorrhea can only survive a certain amount of time outside the body. And remember, gonorrhea is spread through sexual contact. So if you're simply sitting on a toilet seat, you should never get gonorrhea. Myth number three, gonorrhea resolves on its own, so you don't need treatment. This is false. Some cases of gonorrhea does resolve on its own, but you definitely want to get treatment to not only prevent the spread of gonorrhea, but also prevent those complications from occurring. That wraps up today's video on gonorrhea. I hope you learned a thing or two. If you did, please slam that like button and subscribe below. Otherwise, until next time, take care.